Good morning, everybody.
Not one person said good morning. Good morning back.
All right, so if you're out in the foyer, I encourage you guys to make your way inside, and we're just going to start praising the Lord.
Let's stand as we worship.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice! Sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. We are children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord. Bought with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood. Bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let them go. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice! Sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. All our sickness, all our sorrows, Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still. Turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands. Of suffering, he will have you sing. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice! Sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling.
As I change out guitars, that's a stand. If you're still in the foyer, I encourage you guys to make your way in. We're kind of just officially getting started now. So we're going to read scripture together from 1 Chronicles 29. So why don't you guys read this with me? David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly, saying, praise to you, Lord, the God of our father Israel. From everlasting to everlasting, yours, Lord, is the greatest and power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yes, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as high over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. Amen. Let's stay standing and let's sing Hosanna.
hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away.
Joseph's tomb, the end.
mansion sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing. The Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, oh, praise the name of the Lord. one more time. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son,
for this time that we have in your presence, that you have led us here this morning in the sanctuary and in our homes and all around us in creation, Lord, to be with you and to feel that you are close and yet you are with us. And Jesus, as you lead us into a time of knowing you more, we trust you. We pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. We had some wonderful times on Friday night. Many of us came to Shirley and Ian Cook's house and farm for a barbecue. And I just want to thank Shirley and Ian Cook for hosting such a wonderful time. Can we thank them? I think all of us were, we had almost everybody here. At one point, there were half of us in the pool and half of us eating, and it was such a joyous time, and I want to thank everybody that was involved in serving and serving one another. It was really great to gather. This week, we have another picnic in the park at Cultus Lake, Entrance Bay. So please make your way. I believe we started around 5 or 5:30. You bring your own picnic dinner, and we just spend time with one another. And the kids are welcome to play and swim. And Kim has a special treat for the kids this Tuesday. So she asked me to remind everybody about that. So kids, you're going to come? Special treat? It usually has sugar in it. Yes, I want to welcome Graham and Averna Isbister, who are here with us today. It's so wonderful to have you. Graham served as a pastor here. They were pastors here for a long time. 11 years. 11 years, that's right. And I was actually growing up in the church while you were pastoring here. So it's blessed to have you here. Thank you, Elsie. And then the next event for the kids is Bubbles and Buddies and Books on August 18th. And it's actually for all kids. So at 10, if you're a young kid, you can come and we have the books and the bubbles. And then at 11 o'clock, all the kids are welcome to play in the park and to have some food together. So come out for that August 18th. Thank you. And now it is time for the kids to, I want to invite you to go to your Sunday school rooms. And for the kindergarten and up, can you grab a pizza box? And Pastor Kim and the leaders have some special crafts and devotional things ready for you to stay in the service today. Thanks. Let's take time together as a community to pray.
Let's join our hearts in prayer. Our Father, our Heavenly Father. It's so easy to say that glibly, but when we pause to think about it, this is awesome. You have been our dwelling place. It's as though you're there, we live there. The designer, creator, and owner, and sustainer of everything that exists and all that we are is our Father. And we can experience his presence. Wow. And you allow us to be stewards of a tiny bit of your creation. But then we tend to drift away from you and act as though we own it. How audacious of us. We are accountable stewards of all that we have and are. At best, only temporary owners. Forgive us, Lord, for ignoring that. Amazingly, in this vast universe of celestial objects, this Father promises to listen when we pray. Psalm 9 tells us, you do not ignore the cry of the afflicted, and you pay special attention to those whose prayers come from the heart. The fervent prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective, according to James. Why would you bother to listen? How come you even know we exist, buried away in this vastly big universe? We're told that light travels at about 250,000 kilometers per second. That's 15 million kilometers in a minute, over 900 million in an hour. And it takes years, many years at that speed to even reach the edge of our galaxy, let alone all the other galaxies that are out there. How can you even find us? It's mind-boggling that you know all about us and still care enough to listen. Our days are like grass that withers away and is gone. Thank you for your care and compassion in spite of that. We appreciate this abounding love for us. And it isn't that you just listen. You actually promise to help. You're going to stoop to help us. But then, typically, we sometimes take that to a wrong extreme. And in effect, say to you, you know, I've got these plans I figured out that will bring me health, wealth, and happiness. And I want you to make my plans work. You promised to help, didn't you? Well, the answer is, I'm the one with the plans, and I will help you fit into my plans. It's not me fitting into your plans. Lord, teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain a heart of wisdom, it tells us in Psalm 90. Forgive us, Lord. What we want is not always what we need. You'll give us what we need to produce the fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. It's true that you are the God of all comfort and encouragement. But you're even more interested in developing our character than our comfort. And that could take pruning, painful pruning and suffering. Lord, make us willing to face that time of discipline in our lives. At the same time, we are asked, even commanded, to pray for those who are going through pain and suffering. Each person old enough to understand knows someone in those circumstances, perhaps still dealing with the pandemic fallout, financially, emotionally, mentally, relationally, physically, or spiritually. These people are struggling, really struggling, Lord. They need help. We'll pause for silent prayer to invite each person to fervently, earnestly, pleadingly intercede for someone they know that is in that kind of need. We as a community of believers need direction. We pray for the leadership team, for the leader of every ministry and responsibility related to this church and community. Grant us a sense of your Spirit's presence and powerful enabling so that it will honor your name, not ours. We pray for those who are caught in a war zone not of their making. We particularly and earnestly and pleadingly ask that you exert your power to change the hearts and minds of the cruel and senseless aggressors. Stop the war, please. And now as we prepare our hearts to receive your message by Pastor Andrew, may we be ready to hear as well as put it into practice. Amen.
Morning, Sardis. My name's Andrew. I'm one of the pastors here at the church. Just want to, at the beginning, just thank Jerry and Allison for the great job that they've done leading us these last couple weeks while myself and my family have been on vacation. We have been enjoying some time away in Washington State. Wherever there's water, like, we were there. And then we went and took a week on the Sunshine Coast up by Pender Harbor, which is just, like, stunning. Anyone been to Pender Harbor? If you haven't, that's on your next vacation list here. Like, it's so beautiful in that area. Just like, there's like six lakes, an ocean there. It's just incredible. We were in the water like the whole time. When I was in the water at the barbecue, because I didn't really get out of the water, I guess. In the pool the whole time. Someone asked me, actually a few of you asked me, do you feel rested now after a couple weeks of vacation? Do you remember this? Wasn't just you, but do you feel rested after a couple weeks vacation? I can't remember which kid was drowning at that moment. I'm trying to pull him out of the water. Vacation has been really fun. Rested? I don't know if you get a ton of rest when you've got a six-year-old and an almost two-year-old, especially with their energy. Fun? Yeah. Relaxing? I don't know. It's a good thing that my wife, Victoria, has kind of finished with that section of like morning sickness that she's been working through these last couple months. All that nausea, at least we can rest a little bit on that front now. Oh. Did I not tell you that before? Oh, this is awkward. This is why I should stick to my notes, right? Uh-oh. We'll have another. If you thought I would look tired now, just wait till like January, February, or something around then when another little one comes into our family. Yeah. Okay. So it's exciting. Please pray for us. Half joking about that. More seriously, though, we are in a series in the Psalms. You know, I've tried to call this the Psalmer of Psalms. Only some of you got that joke. Okay. You can turn to Psalm 90 now. We're going to be opening up Psalm 90. This psalm, more seriously, would fall into a category Walter Brueggemann would call a disorientation psalm, or maybe more, we'd probably talk about more like lament, I guess. Meaning that the author, the psalmist, the writer, is in a tougher spot than normal. The things have not been going well for him or his community. And he writes this beautiful poetry, trying to give some semblance, some words in prayer to God in this time of need. we're not exactly told what the problem is. Maybe that's helpful to us. If it kind of lined out exactly what all the specific problems were, we could say, well, that's not for me. Perhaps when the problems in the psalm are vague, it allows us to enter into a piece of poetry with our own circumstances in mind, with our own experiences, with our own walks with the Lord. Wherever those places of frustration might be, or anger, or sadness, loneliness, guilt, shame, longing, helps us kind of enter in and join our voices to that of the psalmist. This is what the Psalms do. They take all of our human life experience, emotions, this wide range, and they bring them into conversation with our Creator. When we're tempted to have these conversations elsewhere and just kind of turn away from God, the psalmists help us, ground us, and have this conversation with the Lord. The psalmist is trying to come to grips with the fragility and the shortness of life. The psalmist has likely experienced loss. He's also coming to grips with his own sinfulness and the sinfulness that he sees around him in the community, in the world, and among the nation. He looks out, well, he looks into himself and he looks out into the world and he sees a lot of suffering and a lot of brokenness and sin and pain and death. And he calls out to God, trying to make sense of this reality. We can relate here individually, but we can also relate to this as a community, I think. We live in a world of wars that we've mentioned. We live in a world of pandemics. We live in a world of exploitative and abusive systems that we are just entangled and enmeshed with. We wrestle with our own sins and shortcomings. We wrestle with the sins and the evil of our own nation. We reflect, even just this last couple weeks, the Pope coming to Alberta and everything that has meant, followed of legacies of colonialism and residential schools in our country. We have all of these questions maybe and feelings and emotions, and they're complex, and the answers perhaps there aren't many answers, and we're left with these feelings. Perhaps that can help us enter into the psalm. Overwhelmed, the psalmist cries out for mercy and compassion, and he cries out to God to establish the work of his people's hands, to do what is good and right at this point forward. Despite everything that's happened at this moment, will you help us to live wisely, to walk in a good way, to live justly now? We're going to walk through three sections of the psalm this morning, one at a time, but I want to maybe up front just try my best shot at what the psalmist's point is. And I know it's poetry and it's hard to get, here's the point, but let me try. Despite the shortness and the fragility of life, despite our own brokenness and the sinfulness of us and our people, despite all of that, God remains our home, our dwelling place, a person who can free us from shame, a person who is present to help us live wisely with the time we have left. That's my best shot. Let's open up the first couple verses. Psalmist starts by saying this, Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth or the world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. This is ground zero. This is the starting point. When faced with death and sin and shame and brokenness, this is where we start. The Lord, who has been our dwelling place, our place of abiding, literally our home. This is who we're talking to. Many spiritual writers of the past and present would say that this is the goal. This is the end of the Christian life. To have our home in the Lord. To know him personally. To know him as our place of rest and refuge. That no matter what happens in our internal or external worlds, that he becomes for us this place of abiding, of deep and rich life, our home, a place that we are known and safe and loved. This is what the psalmist, he's going to get into a bunch of other challenges and cry out to God, but this is where he starts. We are at home in the Lord. He is our center, our place of belonging. We cannot fashion other centers of places of belonging for ourselves. These are gifts given to us to receive. Some of us maybe We grew up with homes that were less than safe places. Or maybe we're experiencing homes now that may not be as safe as we would like them to be. Places that are not spaces of rest, where we can be known for our true selves, where we can be safe and loved. The psalmist invites us, all of us, in our different ways and our different experiences and emotions and stories, to find our home in the Lord. For himself to be our home, our place of security, our safe place. Even in the midst of the most drastic and difficult circumstances, there's a word of hope. Walter Brueggemann suggests that it's as if God is his undoubted homemaker, letting us be at home without anxiety. A real home with real hospitality is always a gift rather than an achievement. And that this home is not necessarily a physical place. The psalmist doesn't say that the temple is our home, for example. He could have. Not a building, but a person to know and to be known by, to experience. The Lord is our home. St. Teresa of Lisieux would say that coming home is possible despite whatever is going on in our external world. Perhaps even in our internal worlds, we can retreat into this interior chapel and commune with God there. But despite all of the chaos, there are places that we can reside and abide in and know the goodness and the faithfulness of God, cultivated through prayer. The psalmist says that the Lord has been our dwelling place in all generations and recalls a time that there was only God, how he is creator and the everlasting one who's been there from the beginning and then has provided a home for his people throughout time. This reminds me that there are no self-made followers of Jesus. A few years ago, I was given this Bible, which is a treasure for me. I can't read it. It's written in another language. It's old. It's falling apart. There are probably some pages missing. In terms of its usefulness, like how would this score from 1 to 10? Anybody speak German? It's a silly question to ask, right? In terms of its usefulness, not very useful. But it has a prime spot in my office across from my desk. I can always see it. It's a reminder to me. This book's been handed down from generation to generation. Some folks in the first few pages, there's lists of names and dates, some that I know, others that I don't and have never met. Some of these folks have never heard their stories before. Folks that have modeled the faith and followed the Lord in various contexts, who have lived through incredible hardships, through a series of wars and famine and hardship, and yet who read this book, who found their home in the Lord that this book speaks of, and have passed it on and passed on the faith. It's a reminder, not just of our family stories, which are good gifts. It's not all of us have those kinds of stories, but all of us have come to faith through others and communities, which we're beneficiaries of. The communities have been passing on the faith. There are no self-made Christians. Does that make sense? Just wonder if we, I don't do this very often. Maybe some of you are different than me, but never just stop and just realize God's faithfulness to all generations. Time and time again. Do you ever think about that? And praise God for that and share gratitude? It makes me stop and think, if God has been faithful to so many people through their hardship and challenge, not only does it stir up gratitude, perhaps that makes precedent. That in my own trial, in my own hardship, God will be faithful to me. I want to hold on to some of these kinds of thoughts, the faithfulness and the goodness of God, as we kind of read the next section of the psalm where it gets a bit more challenging. Does that make sense? Here we go. Verse 3. You return man to dust and say, return, O children of man. For 1,000 years in your sight are as but yesterday when it is past, there is a watch in the night. You sweep them away as with the flood. They're a dream. The grass is renewed in the morning, and in the morning it flourishes and is renewed, and in the evening it fades and withers. We're brought to an end by your anger, by your wrath. We are dismayed. You have set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your presence. That's not a great thought. For all our days pass away under your wrath. We turn our ears to an end like a sigh. The years of our life are like 70, or even by reason, by strength of 80. Yet their span is but toil and trouble, and soon they're gone, and we fly away. Who considers the power of your anger and your wrath according to the fear of you? There's two simultaneous thoughts that are running through this section of the psalm. First is the fragility of life. We're basically, in the grand scheme of eternity, this eternal God who's existed from pre-eternity, we're like grass. We're here 1 minute flourishing and then gone the next. There's a second thought that the psalmist juxtaposes with this, although he doesn't always kind of interweave them or rationally kind of, this is how it works, but he kind of just leaves them out there for us to just wrestle with and hold in tension. That our sinfulness has led to all kinds of suffering around us. Sure, the years of life might be 70, sometimes 80, but there's a lot of toil and trouble. Sometimes we ask, is there meaning to be had here? Let me get to this point where God is not unaware of our sin, even those things that we hold with us and carry with us through life that we think are secret. There are no secrets with God. What God's presence does is bring a light even to our sin, which in some ways can be a really discomforting thought. But stay with me, okay? There's this tension. God is good and just and faithful and everlasting, and we are grass. Our lives can be faithful and full of toil and pain and sin. And it's easy to be discouraged by this kind of language, and we want to kind of pass by it and race to the next psalm because they're kind of short, right? We can do Psalm 29 again or something. We can conjure up feelings of guilt and shame for us as we think of our own secret sins coming to light in the presence of God, and we want to race past it onto something else. But if we do that, we miss out on something important. The psalmist brings this up for a few reasons, but it's not to, I don't know, stall his death or to remove his misery or to just kind of just let himself have one, you know, lashing his own back like some of us like to do. His goal is honest self-reflection. His goal is self-awareness brought before the light of God's presence. What I take from this personally is that we so often try to hide things from God, which sounds foolish when you say it out loud, doesn't it? We try to hide stuff from God. What we really do is we hide ourselves. I think this has been the human problem from the beginning. As far back as the garden, the first humans, Eve and Adam, eating the fruit, they don't just try to hide their actions from God, right? What do? They go into hiding themselves. This is what my 2-year-old, when she steals the TV remote, and they catch her eyes, right? And she knows. She knows she's not supposed to have that. What does she do? She bolts. Gone. She's not in the room, is she? Is she hearing this? No, okay. She'd be like, gone. She hides herself. As we do this in our guilt and shame. We hide from our dwelling place, our place of safety and security. Adam and Eve, they hide from their creator. This is the human story that I think it's replayed and replayed and replayed. And we live this story, I think. Is that true? We've been doing it ever since. We still do it. We hide from God. And when we do this, we hold on to our shame and our own guilt. Friends, there are no secrets with God. And sometimes when that's heard, we heap on greater guilt and shame on ourselves and each other. But look at the context. If you keep reading in Psalm 90, the goal here isn't punishment. The goal here is honesty, transparency, vulnerability, and leading towards more relationship. The goal isn't hiding. The goal is to come together. We need vulnerability to experience and receive love, to allow ourselves to be delighted in and to experience the healing power of love with a person who beckons us to come to them. In this case, it's God who is everlasting and faithful, full of unconditional, never-ending love for us, who just beckons us to come. There's a leading researcher on shame and vulnerability, Brené Brown. She says, if you put shame and you were able to put it in a Petri dish, I get excited when I read stuff like this, not the shame part, but like the Petri dish, because I have a whole science degree I never use. It's like, oh, a Petri dish. This is great. If you have a Petri dish and you put shame in it, it needs three ingredients to exponentially grow. Do you know what those ingredients are? Secrecy, silence, judgment. You have all those ingredients, shame can just flourish in that Petri dish and just kind of take over. Now, if you had the same amount of shame in a controlled group, another group over here, you're doing your experiment in the biochemistry lab. Anyone with me in there, the biochemistry lab? No one? Okay, one. If you had the same amount of shame in a Petri dish and you doused it with empathy, perhaps in our case we could define that as unconditional love or compassion, shame cannot survive. The irony here is that we hide from the very thing that has the capacity to heal us. God's self-giving love, his presence, his light. My suggestion for us, and perhaps for myself, is better to be upfront and transparent with God. We no longer have to live with guilt and shame. We can experience light and love and freedom. There is this juxtaposition here because God is our home. We don't need to hide from him. It doesn't work in our self-interest. We can come to him with our faults, knowing our authentic selves. We're not perfect. We have faults and failures. We have sin in our lives. Knowing that his intention is to welcome us, to forgive and cleanse us, and to transform us as we make ourselves at home in him, and for us to receive his love, to know that we are lovable and fallible children of God. This is the goal, I think. The psalmist wants to live an authentic life, an authentic view of oneself that's free and wise, where understanding our limits actually helps us understand who God has created us to be and able to help us make wise decisions in the right timing. The psalmist turns to his third section. He petitions God now as a result of all of this. He says, so teach us to number our days that we may get a heart of wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity, have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad in all of our days. Make us glad for as many days as you've afflicted us, for as many years as we have seen evil. Let your work be shown to your servants and your glorious power to their children. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us and establish the work of our hands upon us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. See, the wisdom in this psalm is not knowing that one day we're all going to die. And on the route to that, that life is simply short and difficult and toil. The wisdom in this psalm is not knowing that we in our world is sinful. If you need a reminder of that, open up your newsfeed. We are inundated with examples of that. Wisdom is where the psalmist petitions God. Petitioning God, pressing the issues, not as an act of defiance, but of fidelity and loyalty. Petitioning God as a natural outflow of who God is and his faithful character and his covenant faithfulness to his people. Wisdom is knowing that our final reality is not defined as grass or dust, but defined by the one who calls us home. In doing that, the psalmist is not bypassing the nature or the fragility of life, the sinfulness of the world, but has this insurance and this insistence towards hope in God's character. For the psalmist, wisdom comes from knowing God as our home and having an authentic and realistic view of who we are, who God's created us to be, with all of our faults and shortcomings and opportunities and joy and gifts in us. And because God is faithful, our days aren't toil. Not simply anyway. God has grace to establish the work of our hands, to actually give meaning into the present, that what we actually do, our work, holds value to God Monday through Saturday. We'll have more about that in the fall. Teaching us to number our days isn't this kind of fatalistic thing. It's freeing us to live into our authentic selves. that we are limited and therefore free to be who God's created us to be. We don't know how much time we have left. You're thinking in this sermon, right? That was a joke, sorry. We don't know how much time each of us has left, but the things we know for sure is that the Lord is our home, that we can, with what days we have left, live them meaningfully. It's been said that what you give your time to is the person or shapes the person you're becoming. So what do we give our time to? Is it in the meaningful work? Is it in the meaningful good things? Or do we just pass the time? Psalmist also teaches us that, yes, God sees our sins and brings them into the light of his presence, but even still, he is a God who will satisfy us with his love, who has compassion on his people, who brings us joy even in the midst of trial. Anybody in a trial today? Yes, our day is a difficult one. We each have our own challenges, but God's offer stands today just as it did yesterday to other generations. The offer's on offer now. We don't need to hide. God beckons us, come. Come home. And that's an offer for every one of us, whether for the first time or once in a long time or again just daily. Come home. Actually, we get to practice it right now. This is how we come to the table, I think. We come to the table with all of our faults and failures, with all of our struggles and our ailments, our afflictions, our suffering. This is where we come, with all of it. We come broken. We come asking God to forgive, asking him to meet us here, to meet us in our affliction and somehow exchange it for joy, to satisfy us with his love that we might have something to rejoice in even if our circumstances don't change like we hope. That when we come to this table, we come knowing that there is a God who beckons us, come home to him, and we get to practice it together in community. We declare together that God is our dwelling place, our home, who is not only everlasting and powerful, but faithful and good and forgiving. God does not tire. This table reminds us that God does not tire of extending grace and compassion to you. So that's what this table represents for us this morning, an exchange. Exchange of our sin and sins that have been done to us and exchanging them for joy. You're welcome to come with your authentic self and to be received to a table of love. This is what Jesus is accomplishing on the cross for his people. God, come to us, home, come to us to be our dwelling place, our home, the one who has stood in our place and substituted himself on our behalf so that toil and death don't have the last word over our destiny. Who does? Well, Jesus. So I want to welcome you. Come home. We don't come to sit around this table because we are sinless or we've earned it. Actually, far from. We come based on God's good and faithful character, how he's welcomed us home to receive his grace and forgiveness, his love and his joy. So in a moment, I want to invite you forward. We're going to have three single file lines on the center aisles. Well, you'll be met with a masked server who will offer you a gluten-free cracker, which represents the body of Christ given for you. And then you will be offered a cup, which represents the blood of Christ shed for you, and you can feel free to take those back to your seats and partake in them there. If the Lord is your home, and your faith and trust is in Jesus, you're welcome to come to this table. However, if you don't wish to participate in communion this morning, feel free to sit and reflect and pray and know that this is the Lord's table, and his welcome to you is simply to come and find your rest in him. For all of us, I invite you to hear the gospel. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink of it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Would you pray with me and as the worship team comes forward and the servers come forward at this time? Lord, this is our prayer, that we confess our shortcomings and our failures to you, that we've sinned against you in thought and word and deed by what we've done and what we've left undone, that we've not loved you with our whole heart. We've not loved our neighbors as ourselves, and we're sorry and we repent. We ask for your mercy and your forgiveness, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, that we would accept this opportunity and this offer to come home, to know your welcome, your steadfast love, your safety, security, that we would know your compassion and your kindness. Would you teach us, Lord? Would you give us wisdom to number our days, that we would live wisely and discerningly, that we would walk in a good way from this day forward with our neighbors and with you, that we might do meaningful work that lasts for you and for your kingdom and for our neighbor. And Lord, we thank you for the cross that makes this possible, your sacrifice for us, for the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus that welcomes us now to be your children, brimming with hope and love and light in the world. Lord, by your wounds we are healed. And so we come to this table in search of healing and wholeness that you provide for us. We pray all of these things in the glory of your name. Amen. I invite you to pause for a moment, reflect and to pray, and when you're ready, I invite you to come and receive.
I invite you, when you're ready, to stand and sing. And if this is a time where you just want to sit and pray too, that's okay.
Beautiful things. I'll stand
I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. One more time, every voice. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. Just the vocals now. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. So I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. And all I am is yours. And all I am is yours. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Let's sing that again. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
If you would like prayer for any reason, I'll be available on the side after the service. Maybe some memories or some thoughts are weighing on you this morning. I'd be happy to stand with you to pray, or perhaps later this week would be more appropriate. I'm happy and available to meet with you and to pray. For now, though, I invite you to take a posture of openness to receive these words, whatever that might look like for you, as we go. Children of God, may you be satisfied in the morning with God's steadfast love. May the Lord make you glad, and may you find your hope, your rest, and your home in Him. As you go today and as you go into this week, may you know the favor of the Lord, and may He establish the work of your hands. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Go in peace.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrender.